Good morning, happy Sabbath, church family. Our God is an awesome God, amen. It's a privilege to be here this morning to be with you and speak to you. When asked to be here today, I was actually kind of surprised. I said, you know, I'm not a big time speaker or anything, don't expect anything big. But the response was, we're not looking for a big time speaker. We're looking for someone that can be used by the Holy Spirit. And I said, then I'm your guy. So I'm glad, I'm happy to be here to share this time with you. I was also asked, how much time do I need for the sermon? And I said, the more important question was, when is potluck? So whenever potluck is, that's when I need to end. So happy Sabbath. It's a privilege to be here. You may have heard a study, or some of you may have heard this before, that people are more afraid of public speaking than of death. And it's true. In other words, people would rather die than to speak in front of a crowd. So as afraid as I am right now, I'm not going to pass out or anything. But fortunately that God is with us here this morning. Amen. So by the grace of God, I'm here to testify of God's love for me throughout my life, the fears of this world that they have placed upon me, and how God and God alone has removed those fears. So I'm not here to say what I want to say. I'm here to say what God wants to say through me. So let us begin with a little prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we want to praise you this morning. We want to acknowledge you as our one and only true God and Creator. We also want to thank you. Thank you so much for your grace, your mercy, and everlasting love. While we were still sinners, you sent your one and only Son, Jesus, to die for us. We are but men, created in your image. We are weak, but you are strong. Fill us with the Holy Spirit this morning as you deliver this message through your humble servant. Even if there is only one who is changed by this message, all of heaven will rejoice over the one who repents and gives his life to you. Thank you, Lord, for your patience with us. We ask for the power of the Holy Spirit to continue to strengthen our walk with you. All these things that we ask in the precious name of your one and only Son, Jesus. Amen. Amen. So the title of the message today is entitled Fear, My Testimonial Punchline. I always like to start out when I'm meeting new people to give a little bit of my testimony, because you want to know a little bit about the person. Whenever you meet someone new, you always ask them a lot of questions, who they are, what they do, all that kind of stuff. But the message today is Fear, My Testimonial Punchline. And I like to define some terms or some meanings. So all of you have heard before a testimony, but what actually is a testimony? Well, it's a written or spoken statement of evidence through an experience. So for example, a person on a witness stand testifying about the experience of a certain event. Now, what is a punchline? Some of you know what a punchline is. It's usually told at the end of a joke of some kind, usually humorous. It's a profound statement intended to provoke a thought from the listener. So if you put the two together, my testimonial punchline means my profound statement of evidence through my experience of how Jesus transformed me and worked in my life. So let's begin by defining the word fear. What is fear? Well, fear is a feeling of anxiety concerning the outcome of something. So for example, those of you who are students or who were students, you may fear the results of having an exam. As adults, you may fear the consequences of the possibility of losing your job or your house or anything else. So to fear, in the worldly sense, is to be afraid of something. So children, are you afraid and fear the punishment you may get from your parents if you do something wrong? Many of us are. Adults, are you afraid and fear the punishment you may get from your parents if you do something wrong? Hopefully not, because we're already adults, right? But to fear in the sense of God is to show reverence and respect and awe. So to respect the power and glory of God and what he has done, is doing, and will do in your life. So a famous quote by the former Franklin Delano Roosevelt, the 32nd President of the United States of America, you may have heard from his inaugural address, So first of all, let me assert my firm belief that the one only thing we have to fear is fear itself. Nameless, unreasoning, unjustified terror which paralyzes needed efforts to convert retreat into advance. So we've become paralyzed by fear because we're unable to do anything about it. I realized that in my decision to accept Jesus in my life, with support of truth from the Bible, the leading of the Holy Spirit, and from having a personal relationship with him, that contrary to what President Roosevelt stated, there really is nothing to fear at all. Why? Because as followers of Jesus and believers of the one true God, the one who created the heavens and the earth, the God of love, we already know the ending of this spiritual battle called the Great Controversy. In other words, Jesus has already defeated Satan, the cause of all fear and sin in this world. When Jesus died on the cross for you and for me, it was all over. So, my testimonial punchline is, when I feared the world, I feared to serve and follow God. Only when I began to fear God, I began to serve and follow him. So in other words, if you translate that, when I was afraid of what the world thought about me, I was afraid, ashamed, and embarrassed to follow God. But when I allowed the Holy Spirit to work in me and show me his true character of love through Jesus, I began to love him, serve him, and follow him. So now that I've given you my testimonial punchline, I have to give you some sort of testimony, right? So there's two major experiences I like to share with you in which I feared the world rather than God. The first one is my journey as a tennis prodigy. The second one is my journey to becoming a licensed architect. So my first experience, the young tennis prodigy. My father, who is here with me today, he taught me how to play tennis at the age of 2 years old. He had seen that I had a good attention span, I listened well, and followed instructions well. At 5 years old, my parents entered me in my first 12 and under tennis tournament. But because I was only 5 years old and possibly not mature enough to play, the tournament director had doubts of accepting me into the tournament. So prior to the tournament, the director had me come in to the tennis club to quote-unquote audition for the tournament. But after watching me play against the kids twice my age and twice my height, I was able to enter the tournament. Unfortunately, though, I lost my first match, but the very next year as a six-year-old, I won the same tournament. Because of my age and small stature, my tennis matches always seemed like David versus Goliath. Just like the children of Israel, who were considered little and weak at times, were often considered underdogs. They had to fight against the Goliath-like enemies. But because of their reputation of having the one true God on their side, they were feared by their enemies, and they were able to defeat them. So my challenge to you is live for God and allow him to work miracles in your life to overcome your Goliath-like situations. In the words of David the shepherd boy, "The Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will rescue me from the hand of the Philistine." Now the stats for my tennis career, I guess you can call it. Fast forward, like any athlete or musician or any profession striving for perfection, many years I spent hours practicing daily and traveling often to tennis tournaments. During the school year, we'd be gone on most weekends, and the weekends I did not have tournament, I attended church. During the summers, we'd be gone weeks or even months at a time. Throughout the years, I've developed a reputation in the tennis community as being one of the top tennis players. So, as a top tennis player, I was feared by my opponents. As one of the top-ranked players in a tournament, my name would often be written in red. So, if my opponent didn't already know me by reputation or by name, they still feared playing against me because my name would be written in red. I was a number one varsity player in high school all 4 years. I won the high school Central Valley Championship as a sophomore, was named MVP 2 years in a row. I was ranked number one in the Central California region, ranked in the top 5 of the Northern California division, and ranked as high as 55 in the United States. Now, to some or many of you, these stats probably mean nothing. But it means a lot to those in the tennis community. Now, earlier I mentioned my reputation as a good tennis player and the reputation of the children of Israel as following the one true God. I learned that whatever you do for a living, wherever you live, or whatever group of people you're associated with, reputation goes a long way, in either a negative or positive way. As a side lesson, the way you live your life establishes your reputation of how much God is the center of your life. In Proverbs 22, verse 1, it says, "A good name is more desirable than great riches. To be esteemed is better than silver or gold." Now, here's my big decision. Since I've been playing tennis all my life, I didn't go to church as often as I should because a lot of the tournaments were on the weekends. Tennis took up a lot of my time. As time went on, I felt a disconnect with God and my church family. Relationship with God and the church became superficial. I felt a void in my life and realized that it was God missing in my life. He was always there, but the problem was I misplaced him. He wasn't the center of my life. Tennis was. The void or gap I felt was filled with selfish, temporary things that eventually emptied and had to be refilled more often in bigger and bigger doses. Another side lesson. God is the ultimate cure to having a fulfilling, satisfying life. In Philippians 4, verse 19, it reads, "And my God will meet all your needs according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus." In other words, Jesus created you and me. He knows what's best for you and me. He has a manual called the Bible that has all the answers to having a fulfilling and satisfying life. Therefore, the answer to all life's questions has always been God. My senior year in high school, I decided to give my life to Jesus. And because of that, I decided to stop competing on the Sabbath and to be more involved in church. So basically, it meant I could no longer play tennis tournaments on the weekends or at all, or any sanctioned tournaments or any major team events because they were all held on Sabbath. I was blessed with the talent of playing tennis and all the successes that came with it, but the focus wasn't on God, it was on me and what I've accomplished, what tournaments I've won, and what my ranking was. I wasn't using my successes in tennis to bring others to Jesus or to glorify him. I was trying to win and succeed to have others glorify me. This was the mindset of Lucifer and the beginning of sin, glorifying self rather than glorifying the ever-loving, merciful God. In Isaiah 14, verses 12 to 15, this is Jesus talking about Lucifer. "How you have fallen from heaven, morning star, son of the dawn. You have been cast down to the earth, you who once laid low the nations. You said in your heart, 'I will ascend to the heavens. I will raise my throne above the stars of God. I will sit enthroned on the mount of assembly, on the utmost heights of the sacred mountain. I will ascend above the tops of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High.' But you are brought down to the realm of the dead, to the depths of the pit." So I eventually took baptismal Bible studies and made a public statement for God by getting baptized a few days before my biological birthday. A lot of people ask me, so which birthday is more meaningful to you, or which one is more important? Well, of course, I'd have to say both. Because if God didn't allow me to physically be born, then I wouldn't have had the opportunity to know him and be spiritually reborn. So it was one of the greatest days of my life. It signified that I gave up something major in my life, which was tennis, for something even greater, which was Jesus. In Matthew 6:24, as read earlier in the scripture reading, "No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money." And that is the one thing with people who are either celebrities or stars or have wealth or power, you cannot serve two masters. You can only serve one. But if you serve the one only true God who has the power of gifting you wealth and power and fame, you will have all those things regardless. All you have to do is to serve him. Now, the fear factor in this testimony. I was happy and flattered when people acknowledged me because of my tennis accomplishments. It was nice to know that my reputation as a great tennis player preceded me. You have to understand, tennis was my life up to this point. My identity was directly connected to being a great tennis player. My life was centered around tennis, competition, winning and losing. It was about me. My fear factor was I feared about what others thought about me now that I had stopped competing in tennis. Would they still think I'm a great tennis player? Would I still be accepted or praised? Will they stop paying attention to me? When I stopped competing, the fear, the paranoia, and doubt of who I was would become present and make me feel anxious. I felt unworthy and lost because my identity would no longer be associated with being a great tennis player. So again, my testimonial punchline is, when I feared the world, I feared to serve and follow God. Only when I began to fear God, I began to serve and follow him. So now, the architect journey. As I mentioned previously, tennis was my life. But becoming a licensed architect was a dream of mine since I was a kid playing with Legos. Completing my college education in architecture has been a long, long, long journey. With the amount of time I spent trying to complete my college degree in architecture, I could have been a medical doctor already by this time. It took so long because I transferred from one school to another for various reasons. And in fact, my last year in college, I was so burnt out with studying, taking exams, working, and the long hours in the architecture studio that I had failed my senior thesis in architecture. In a conference with my instructors regarding my graduation status, I flat out told them that I'm so burnt out right now that if I don't pass my senior thesis class, I'm not going to come back to repeat it at all. That's how burnt out I was. I was giving up and ready to move on with life without my college degree in architecture. But by the grace of God, I had enough points to pass, graduate, and receive my bachelor's degree in architecture. Now, if school didn't take so long, the journey to actually taking all the exams for licensure took so long. During the years that followed, I began preparing for my architectural license exams and worked as a draftsperson in various architecture firms. My exams consisted of 9 separate written exams and 1 oral interview exam. But as life events happen, for example, marriage and having kids, studying for the exams, failing and retaking the exams, they were starting to take a toll on me, just like my last year in college. For any exam I did not pass, there was a 6-month waiting period before retaking the same exam. So again, I was having another identity crisis. I felt incomplete as a person, unaccomplished, a failure, unworthy, lost, depressed, and felt another void that had to be filled. I was no longer a tennis star, and I still wasn't a licensed professional. When the recession hit, I was let go at the architecture firm, became a stay-at-home dad, and tried giving tennis lessons in the evenings. And my wife and I would have been fine with me being a stay-at-home dad and teaching tennis at night, because then I could take care of the house, I can do the yard, I can take care of the kids, but not so good with cooking. But I feared what the world thought of me. In the world's view, there still exists this stigma for men. Being a stay-at-home dad often leads to the misconception of a lazy dad. As a man or husband, you have to have a stable job and be the main provider for the family. But here's the problem. Satan, the great deceiver, deceives you by making you believe that if you're not up to par to the world's standards, beliefs, ideals, then you're nothing. If you're not a star, if you're not a celebrity, if you're not rich or wealthy, famous, or professional of some kind, then you are nobody. while I was beginning to feel like a nobody. You can only resist a thought for so long, but after a while, you keep getting pressed down and feeling the weight of the world overcoming you, and you start believing the lies. In John 16, verse 33, it says, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. In 1 John 5, verses 4 to 5, it reads, For everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. God has always been there with me, but I relied on myself, my strength, and my own understanding to get me through my worries and doubts. I realized that I had to give it all to him to carry the burden and to live life his way, not mine. In Matthew 11, verses 20 to 30, it says, Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart. And you will find rest in your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So again, my testimonial punchline. When I feared the world, I feared to serve and follow God. Only when I began to fear God, I began to serve and follow him. When I was afraid of what the world thought about me, I was afraid, ashamed, and embarrassed to follow God. But when I allowed the Holy Spirit to work in me and show me his true character of love through Jesus, I began to love him, serve him, and follow him. So as a result, I began to have a close relationship with Jesus and eventually passed my architectural exams. I began to rely on him more and more rather than my own abilities, my own understanding. Now, in my mind and in my heart, I believe my identity is that I'm a child of God. I'm someone who loves Jesus for who he is and what he's done for you and for me. Regardless of the details of this testimony, or anyone's testimony for that matter, all you ever really need to know is this. I once was lost, and now I'm found because of Jesus. So in closing, what does this world make you fear that keeps you from giving your life to God and serving him? Are you like me having a difficult decision of giving up something major in your life that has given you a worldly identity and fearing what the world will think of you if you were to give it up? Have you ever been ashamed or embarrassed to follow and serve Jesus because it conflicts with what's cool and acceptable to the world? Is your fear of the world dictating how you live your life for Jesus? My prayer for each of you is to experience your own testimonial punchline. Make Jesus the focus of your life and your identity. And as my daughter Sienna comes up and prepares to play this song, as you listen, think about how great God's faithfulness is in your life. Remember, you cannot serve two masters. Fear God and serve the only master in your life.